Southfield Road is a very important road, a major thoroughfare in this area. And I think we'll all be served, better served if all communities would be better served if we have a shared vision for the thoroughfare, as well as in our negotiations with the Oakland County Road Commission. And I'm specifically thinking about funding for the eventual rebuilding of this road. So with that, Mr. Crowe?
Good evening. As many of you are aware, we're currently under an 18-month environmental assessment of Southfield Road by the Road Commission of Oakland County. Earlier in the year, Lathrup Village hosted a public workshop to take input. Our city engineer is here to add any questions specifically about the process. We have some of the profiles that are listed up there on the board. But we also, at the same time, the city of Southfield has just kicked off its process of updating the master plan. This is a 12-month process. Our master plan was last adopted in April of 2009, and we hope to bring it back for city council consideration in April of 2013. And we use this opportunity to kick off our public workshops on March 20th with a focus on Southfield Road Corridor. And I'd like to just share with you briefly some of the common themes and issues that came up at our first public workshop and open house. We had about 40 or 50 people in attendance, including representatives from Lathrup Village as well as Beverly Hills. One of the issues was that working together, we should be conducting an inventory and analysis of existing businesses to determine what needs there remain in the corridor. There's a lot of discussion about many different profiles of the Southfield Road Boulevard, how will it make it better for pedestrians and businesses, being respectful to the plans that Lathrup Village has for a more walkable downtown, as well as a transition to the north at Beverly Hills. Traffic congestion was a big issue, and I am eliminating pedestrian and vehicular conflicts, making the corridor more walkable. I think many people felt that we still haven't decided what the right sizing of the boulevard is. Everybody agrees that decreasing speeds, providing some traffic calming, and making the area more walkable is important. I think our joint goal is to seek new businesses that complement existing businesses, and also to seek the right mix of uses. Because we're all in this together, people recognize that regional cooperation and cooperation between adjacent communities is very important, so that we have a unified front when dealing with the Road Commission of Oakland County, as well as Oakland County in general. There were some concerns about redevelopment of vacant parcels, and there was some representatives from the business community there that said that we all need to balance the needs of the business community versus the needs of the residents. They've shared their frustrations with the lack of development opportunities along Southfield Road frontage. We talked about out-parcel development, for example, breaking up the sea of asphalt in front of our big boxes such as Home Depot. We talked about reviewing best practices in other older community corridors, conducting exit interviews when businesses do leave the area. It was also talked about being sensitive to existing retail and the small mom-and-pop shop owners. And I think everybody agreed that developing gateways into each of our respective communities was important for unifying the corridor as well as identifying our individual needs. And we wanted to create a positive image of Southfield Corridor, and sometimes that's not always the case. There were some specific issues and comments with regards to our existing land use patterns and plans, as well as what's being proposed with the Road Commission of Oakland County. But I think most of the issues that were raised are common issues that each of us as a community can work together on. And with that, that's my brief presentation, and myself and other staff will be available to answer questions later on in our discussion. Thank you. Mr. Brown?
Mr. Mueller.
Good evening, Jeff Mueller, Lathrup Village. I actually like to first take thankful after getting everybody together. I think we should have been doing this probably a long time ago as we're all neighbors and are really trying to work together. I think as you look at some of the things that Terry was talking about, those are all the same things we're really striving for in Lathrup Village. The thing that really got us going was the road commission. We were going to be the first section of Southfield Road that was going to be completed, and they wanted to drop a 60-foot median in there, which is probably similar to Telegraph Road, and raise the speed limits up to 50 miles an hour, which was the city of Lathrup Village is trying to create a downtown area or feel right within the center city. Right, so we have a new zoning area called the Village Center, whereas we're hoping that the school will be redeveloped and some other development areas. We want to slow the traffic down. We want to make it more pedestrian-friendly. We've done a lot of work so far. We've already updated our master plan, which actually we're about ready to look at again here this upcoming year. We've adopted a complete streets ordinance and actually tied right in with our zoning. The DDA is actively looking at properties and looking at redevelopment. But I think we want to do a lot of things that Terry had mentioned, slow the traffic down and yet hopefully come up with some kind of development for the area. Make it pedestrian friendly, and really I echo a lot of the things that Terry had said. We just look forward to working with your city and Beverly Hills. So, thanks.
On behalf of the Village Council of Beverly Hills, thank you to the City of Southfield for hosting. Again, we were working kind of separately on some of our own issues regarding Southfield Road, so I think it's timely that we discuss this. Separately, what the Planning Board, under the direction of the Village Council, has been considering for the Village of Beverly Hills is an overlay district for a commercial corridor on Southfield Road, roughly from 13 Mile to Beverly Road, which is a halfway point between 13 and 14 Mile. The concept of an overlay district is to encourage redevelopment based upon a form-based code, which if you've dealt with before, is slightly a move away from a code based simply on zoning uses, single uses on lots, and more toward encouraging development based upon form and function and the design of buildings. But an overlay district, this would be a voluntary ability, but the concept is that by allowing for a higher density and perhaps a higher level of use than is currently allowed in our zoning, we would be able to provide incentives to developers to redevelop that parcel in a perhaps a more modern and more use-intensive way that would have higher density, higher purpose uses along the corridor on Southfield Road with perhaps even higher elevations and transitioning back into our residential neighborhoods to the north and to the west. The Planning Board has actually produced their first draft of that, which they are currently reviewing, and will probably be reviewing at their next public meeting. We've worked a little bit with a consultant, Robert Gibbs. He's done a lot of work in Oakland County, a lot of work really throughout the country on this type of development. And we're getting input from him as to what the market will bear in that area and to make sure that the codes that we are considering are appropriate. And as Lathrup has done, we also had an open house on this process where we invited the public in and a lot of our business owners along the corridor to get their input. We did get some level of concern about building height and concern about residents that not exactly certain the 4 or 5 story buildings are the way that we want to go. And again, we're not certain that even if the market would support that. But I think the biggest part we're looking for in the code is to make sure that our code, our zoning regulations in that area are not holding back development. A lot of that zoning was developed, those zoning regulations were, in our case, were put in the late 50s and early 60s. And the thoughts behind those were developed even earlier than that. And I'm not certain a lot of that really allows for the kind of development that might be feasible in the area today. Again, as you've had concerns about walkability, safety for residents and bicycle pedestrians, and a real concern on being able to cross Southfield Road safely by foot or by bike, which probably doesn't really exist through our community right now. I think the same is in yours, particularly at Southfield Road and 13 miles is our biggest concern. It's a bit of a traffic problem, and it's really not feasible at this point. To, and certainly not inviting to pedestrian traffic, and we would look to change that. One other thing we've also kind of considered in conjunction with that, and it's been a bit of a busy time for us, but the planning board is also very concerned about signage in our community, and it'll be a very long process, which we've just recently completed, to redo our sign ordinance. We did a complete inventory of all commercial signage throughout the entire village. Obviously, most of that was located within this corridor, and to get an idea of what we had and what we would like eventually to transition to. So the planning board spent a significant amount of time redoing our sign ordinance, moving away from pole signs, more towards ground signs, and trying to incentivize the type of signage that we think would be appropriate for the village going forward. I can see I've hit upon a very popular topic in the I will say no more on that and not cause my friend Mr. Schrader any problems. But that was not an easy process. We spent a lot of time doing that, and an awful lot of time with discussions about what's appropriate. And again, we did redraft the ordinance. There will be an awful lot of signage exists in our community that will be not conforming. It does not mean it has to go. But over time, the thought is that will be transitioned out into a different type of signage throughout the community. So that was quite a large undertaking. We'll think it was the filling of the planning commission, but those two, the rezoning and the signage, really worked together, and they wanted to do those both at the same time. So,
I want to know how the relationship with Southfield Township and Beverly worked out.
Sure. Yeah, that's probably a worthwhile point. I know most of you are maybe not aware of that commercial district that runs north of 13 Mile Road. It is the village of Beverly Hills on the west side where the Market Fresh and the Brady's are located. But on the east side, that part is in Southfield Township, including the Acacia Park Cemetery and the property where the old borders used to be, where the new Books a Million will be starting April 20th. There'll be an open house in right to all the 10 brand new Victorian corner of Southfield. Shameless plug, I couldn't help it. And the new village fire truck will be there as well. So I invite you all to come take a look at that. But that entire parcel is under the jurisdiction of the Southfield Township. They do have a separate planning commission for that. We do provide public safety services for that. Well, the service, it's pretty seamless because we do provide the most of the services for that. But they have been kept abreast of everything that we are doing. They're not considering at this point the same kind of holistic zoning change, but I think if we do it, we're successful. I think it will be under some consideration. But that corner shopping plaza has probably been more successful than a lot of development on the west side of the corner. They've had some good, strong tenants in there. It was very unfortunate what happened with borders, and the legal borders had nothing to do with the viability of that particular location. That was one of the unprofitable stores nationwide. It was just still an unfortunate reality of that particular retail industry. But, that has been probably a bit of the shining star of that corridor, even though we do have, very good businesses. We have the Beverly Hills Grill, Premier Pest, we have some places that are doing well. It's just, as you probably struggle with, we have multiple property owners at different stages in there. And their ownership of that property with different interests, and so it's been a bit of a problem we've seen about how is that going to redevelop when you've got so many different property owners on so many different parcels. So hopefully through the overlay district it might incentivize some consolidation of some of that ownership and the consideration of development on a larger scale.
What about the residential
You're talking about like on the north, on the, kind of going north of Beverly?
North of Southfield, between 15 Road and the Southfield line, is there Southfield Township, so residential?
The residential is all Village of Beverly Hills at this point. There is residential to the north side of that, and it's probably also worth mentioning. I think one of the things the Village of Beverly Hills has pushed for, and I think we would encourage the City of Southfield and Lathrup to join us in this effort, is I think the Road Commission was a little bit short-sighted in their initial concept of this corridor, this Southfield corridor redevelopment, just stopping at 15 Mile Road, and it really kind of got on our radar immediately that that's going to leave a bit of an awkward transition. I mean, it's already, frankly, a little bit awkward the way that the traffic kind of slows down and it goes from commercial all the way to Beverly Road, and then it's residential, but it's still, five-lane autobahn speed until you get to Birmingham 14 Mile, which then goes down to two-lane, very much slowly in residential. I think the Road Commission, it will be incumbent upon them to consider that entire corridor all the way to 14 Mile. And I really impressed upon them that if you cut off, that even though they're different jurisdictions, that the commercial district from 13 to Beverly is really no different than everything that exists functionally. It's not any different than what exists all the way back down to M39. And if they just transition that that new median, whatever they're going to build, 1,500 feet north of 13 Mile Road and cut off our section in the middle, it's going to be a very awkward transition. They need to consider the commercial district of 13 Mile and also that stretch from Beverly to 14 and how they want to transition that. We've even talked with them about possibly transitioning that back down to maybe three lanes through there as well as opposed to five, because there is a tremendous amount of traffic that proceeds through Southfield. If you look at the traffic pattern, through Southfield Road all the way to 14, back east along 14 Mile to Woodward. I mean, that stretch of 14 Mile between Southfield and Woodward carries a tremendous volume of traffic for a three-lane road. The Road Commission knows this because it's all theirs, and they're aware of this. But I think they need to consider how they're going to transition those traffic flows all the way through, because it's clearly the traffic doesn't stop at 13. Some of it, but not a lot of it. It does pass through, and so we're going to take a very strong position with the Road Commission that whatever plan they come up with needs to incorporate at a minimum the Beverly Road, if not the 14 Mile. We appreciate our neighboring communities just have to join us in that. I think it is critical. I believe so.
Just to be clear, Chris, the shopping center where Borders was and the cemetery south of Township, right?
That is correct, yes, sir.
And then on the Market Fresh and all the way up, that's Beverly Hills.
Yes,
retail on that side.
Yes, that is.
And then after the cemetery, there's housing, and that's Beverly Hills.
That is very, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
The Southfield Township trustees and their administration are aware of this meeting tonight. They were, I did invite one of our trustees, and in turn she invited the other trustees. No one was able to attend tonight. I was hoping that our past president of the village council, Roseanne Costa, be here, but she could not. The last minute something came up. So they're aware of what's going on, and they'd like to be involved from the standpoint of knowing what's going on and what's going on in that section, especially. They would like to join in the effort if there was something that needed to go forward where they could help out with the Road Commission. From the standpoint of, do they have a lot of input? Most of their input kind of sides with what Beverly Hills is doing, because most of them are see that as Beverly Hills, and they're part of most of the people who reside in Beverly Hills.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
I just wanted to point out on this map here, in the light green, the light
green though in front of that, the dark green in front of that light green is actually also Southfield Township. That's very shopping plaza.
Okay. I'll open the floor to questions or other comments. Mayor?
One of the things, I'm really glad that we are all here. I thank the our council president for his leadership in getting this meeting together. But I really wanted to get a sense of, and the kind of, we haven't talked with. And so, to me, to have three different developments moving forward is confusing to the Road Commission. So, you have Southfield Road, beginning at around 9 Mile, and then we get to Lincoln, it becomes a Lathrup Village, and then it gets to 12 Mile, becomes Southfield, then it becomes Beverly Hills, and along the way, we all have to agree on, I feel strongly, we're not going to get a new Southfield Road if we don't come to an agreement. Can someone between our planner and our city managers who are here, where are we on reaching a consensus to moving forward?
I'm going to defer to our city engineer, who's been our representative on the Southfield Road Corridor. She may give us an update on just on where we are in the process.
Ms. Schultz, why don't you come up? Good evening.
So, what was the question?
We have three communities here, and there's another in Southfield Township. And there has to be some form of consensus or agreement, because you can't have four different plans going down that stretch of Southfield Road. Where are we with reaching consensus so that the road commission is in agreement and we're all in agreement so we can move forward? Because my understanding, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, there has been some pushback from the road commission because each community is pushing their own plan and they're not connected.
Well, that's all going to be part of this process. And there's going to be a meeting set up soon within the next few weeks where the steering committee comes back together. So there are members.
Who's on the steering committee?
I'm one of the members on the steering committee.
Mm-hmm.
And each community has at least one member on that steering committee.
Mm-hmm.
And all the alternatives that were originally presented, the Spalding the Decker, who's been working for the road commission, doing the analysis, he's been going through the traffic studies and everything to see of the possible options, which ones are feasible, and because they're looking at, you know, the traffic safety and got to make sure that it can handle the traffic. And it may not be exactly the same for every piece of the road along the way. I mean, obviously, it's a bit different of a use from the Southfield Freeway up to 696,
mm-hmm.
and then north of 696. So, I mean, that's something that at that steering committee, you know, we can come together with that as long as we're all coming with the same message. And the representative from Spalding the Decker that's heading that whole project just showed up. Good timing, so if she could probably answer more specific questions since it's been a little while. We haven't had a steering committee meeting yet since the last public meeting, so they've also been incorporating those comments that they've received from the public.
Would you introduce this person and have her come up?
This is Cheryl Gregory. She's from Spalding the Decker Associates. And she's the one, they're under contract by the Road Commission, but Spalding the Decker is actually heading the whole process for this environmental assessment.
And would you give your name and business address for the record, please?
Yes, my name is Cheryl Gregory. I'm the project manager for the environmental assessment study hired by the Oakland County the Road Commission for Oakland County. My address is 905 South Boulevard East, Rochester Hills.
My question is, what is the process? Where are we at it? What's the timeline? And what is the expectation of the Road Commission so that we can get the Southfield Road that we want it to?
I'll give you the abbreviated version.
Thank you. I know it's your brain, you're protesting her.
Back in 2004, we were hired by the Oakland County Road Commission to do a redesign of Southfield Road, starting with the first phase from 11 Mile to 12 Mile Road. That design was underway for a few years. It got stalled for a variety of internal reasons, administrative reasons, but it was stopped at about 65% complete design plan completion because Lathrup Village had raised their hand and said, we'd really like to talk more about what the vision of Southfield Road is before the reconstruction starts. So the Road Commission said, okay, let's do that. So they stopped the design process, and in 2012, they began the process to undergo an environmental assessment, which is an FHWA requirement when you're going to change the functionality of a roadway that they provide funding for. So that actually began last summer, and we're about 8 months into a 24-month process, whereby a series of public meetings, community-targeted stakeholder meetings are going to be conducted. We've had three steering committee meetings. We've had one public meeting. And like Ms. Schultz said, we're in the process of scheduling a follow-up steering committee. Based on the input we received on December 10th, our first public input meeting. And since December 10th, Our team has been analyzing. We've gotten a ton of traffic data. We've got 7 alternatives that we're looking at, and the alternatives were developed based on the purpose and need for the project, as well as specific input from Lathrup Village, City of Southfield, Beverly Hills, and Southfield Township isn't too involved in it. There's they don't have a great deal at stake with it, so there's not been a lot of involvement by them. But the final completion date is tentatively scheduled for fall of 2014, where we're looking, by that time, the process, we're hoping the process will have played itself out. So there's a series of reviews by the Road Commission, by the Michigan Department of Transportation, and by the Federal Highway Administration. And once everybody has a confidence level that all of the alternatives have been thoroughly vetted, we will hopefully arrive at a finding of no significant impact. We call it a FONSI, a finding of no significant impact, and we're hoping to receive that by the FHWA in fall of 2014. At that point, we can begin design on the alternative that the communities have approved and the Road Commission has approved.
Yeah, I think the big question is there going to be a median, and if so, how big is it going to be? We saw a plan originally that was a 60-foot median, and frankly, many of us just were appalled at that. I'm not sure, and I'd like to hear really from Lathrup, because I know at one time you wanted a median, and then you didn't want a median or something, or I'm not sure where Lathrup is. And I think that ultimately, that's part of your job?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And several of our alternatives have medians of varying widths. And we're looking at how that will function.
The city of Lathrup Village, certainly, I mean, this planning process for this road goes back how many years?
2004.
It's a long, long time, I know that. And the original concept. And I'm not clear whose idea it was originally, but I think it's probably the Road Commission's, the idea of putting that median in there. Lathrup, I think, was accepting of the idea of a median of some sorts all along. But we, like you, when you saw, we saw a 60-foot median, felt that was not the vision we had or that we wanted to pursue. We have a community that's been divided already by a wide thoroughfare called Southfield Road, and another 60 feet in the middle of it for a median, and we think makes the problem of dividing our community much more severe than it would be otherwise. So that was one of the things that caused us to step back and say we need to re-examine this. We spent a lot of time looking at our own master plan, our own vision for what we wanted the center city of Lathrup Village to look like, and come up with after a lot of input from residents, from businesses, and the community. We feel we've got a vision that we're pretty settled on and we think would work. And that constitutes using, recommended to the Road Commission, a median of a much more compact nature, at the very least. We also, I think, Jeff and I have talked about this many times, as we looked at this process, that this meeting tonight is probably long overdue between the three communities that are involved here, because if we don't develop a vision that we at least find compatible among the three communities and that we can all stand together with,
exactly,
I think we may find a product, one of two outcomes. One is there won't be a reconstruction of the road. That's one possibility. The other would be an outcome that certainly leaves all three parties of the main cities along there unhappy with whatever the result is.
Mm-hmm.
And, each one of us, I think, is probably at a slightly different point in terms of our internal discussions. Lathrup, I think, is quite far down the road of what we envision for our own city area. But this should be, the goal of this should be, in my opinion, is that we come together, come up with a vision. We may have to deputize our various planners take some of the comments and the research that's already been done and come up with a draft of something we can all look at and say, can we get a common vision from the three of us for this corridor?
Well, Frank, do you have a vision tonight? I mean, do you have a draft? I just heard some things, median, no median, parking off the street.
Yeah, in fact, we have boards here to kind of demonstrate.
I can't see them here.
Maybe you could be lined up here.
Which one are you talking about, Frank?
Jeff and I will set it up.
Yeah. We'll set it up right there. We do have, Mr. Chairman, we also have a map that we could unroll over on this table with your maps, I think. It shows the corridor with the size of the...
Is your mic
on?
He's not talking.
Sorry, can you hear me now?
The green button.
The green button, you guys do something with that?
For a showcase. Oh, that's too bad. Politicians should always know where the button is, right? Yeah. But anyway, that particular drawing, which is one that's been a working document with the Road Commission, does demonstrate the size of the median that we are leaning towards.
And one of the things, the reason why I'm asking this question is that it concerned me that in 2004, I was around, and we thought we were moving forward, and then, you know, we were informed that Lathrup Village stopped it. And then here we are in 2012, and as we said, we have to have, we've got to come together because that road needs to be repaired. And we lost the funding window, and I want to see the plan because it is going to be challenging to create a downtown on Southfield Road. And I understand the vision, and I know what the downtowns are, but to have parallel parking on Southfield Road is going to be very challenging. But I, you know, that's the village. But what I want to say is, we have this 2014 fall, and I would hope that everyone in this room will be committed to coming together. And you know what they said? Something we all won't like. They said the best. And you know you have consensus when everybody has a little bit of what they want and everybody else is a little disappointed. So I see this as being that because we're different communities, but we have in common that major artery running through our community, and we need to come together to get it fixed.
One thing, if I could, maybe correct me if I'm wrong, that actually different concepts for the corridor potentially could be done. It doesn't have to be a one-size-fits-all from 9.5 mile up to 13 or 14. I know that the Road Commission's concerned about bottlenecks and that we don't have a thoroughfare and all of a sudden it's down to 25 or something. But, I mean, I think we thought a median would absolutely be fine. It just was the 60-foot median. We would have lost 780 parking spaces on Southfield in front of all the businesses that have been there. And in fact, you're going to put them all out of business. So we had concerns there. And, you know, maybe there's some happy medium that we can do that would provide a safe haven for pedestrians yet allow the traffic to move through actually slower. Our traffic planners have told us you slow the speed limit down, it's safer, and you can actually pass more cars through there than at a higher speed because they can follow closer together. And, you know, we've given some of that information to the Road Commission. So whether or not we have parking on the street, I'm not so sure. I think we're looking at a perpendicular street that wouldn't necessarily impact is too great.
Can we look more high-rise and mid-rise?
High-rise is three-story for us. And the zoning laws are five.
I have a question.
part of the analysis. If I may, I'd like to list some of the components of the roadway that we're vetting out. And like Mr. Mueller said, we're not looking at it from the Southfield Freeway to 13 Mile Road as having a uniform. Mm-hmm. We understand that the community needs are different. That said, we're looking at a variety of cross-sections, 7-lane cross-section, 5-lane cross-section, 6-lane boulevard with a wide median, 6-lane boulevard with a narrow median, 4-lane boulevard, varying median widths, keeping existing intersections by improving left turn phasing or replacing some key existing intersections with roundabouts, looking at sidewalks, multi-use paths, on-street bike lanes, making sure that public transportation has room for bus stops, mid-block pedestrian crossings, on-street or adjacent street parking, also access road parking, the idea of an access road within the public right-of-way, and the ability to accommodate turns and truck movements for all of those options. So there's a number of alternatives that we're looking at right now, and I do want to stress that we understand that the functionality of the corridor from the freeway, between the freeways, 696 and Southfield, we understand that has a different feel to it. From 696 to 12 Mile has a different feel to it. 12 Mile to 13 has a different feel for it. And we're analyzing it in those segments for that reason.
The last thing I wanted to comment on, you know, we have the 8 Mile Authority. There is the Woodward Avenue Authority. I would think to have some form of uniformity, even in landscaping, it could be different things, but it would be wonderful once, you know, we get there that we have an authority, if it's possible, I would like to recommend that we look at a Southfield authority that looks at beautification, look at finding funding to support businesses and facades and things like that. And it works, I mean, 8 Mile is amazing and Woodward is as well. And it works really well. So I just wanted to put that on the table. That might be something not so much the Road Commission would do, but as of coming together to look at having the authority, and you can make some, you can get funding and really, and you know, we all are graded on how we collaborate. And that could be a collaboration that we could come together and actually start looking at how we can continuously invest in the South of the Road long after this road repair is done.
I was listening to the comments and here 2014. But I guess I'm really trying to look at this realistically. There's a lot of work that's being done to aim at that date to have something ready to go. Funding isn't necessarily going to follow the plans that are being proposed. So you may look at 2014 as a plan on which the county or state wanted to expand Southfield Road, but you know, when is funding going to be available? I mean, in Washington, things are all over the place, and the county has no money. And I mean, that's, you know, you have to look at this realistically. And I was at the meeting of the Oakland County when they showed the options on Southfield Road in Lathrup Village City Hall, and I've seen parallel parking on Southfield. You know, it's got expressway traffic count. I don't know anybody who will back up a car onto Southfield Road. It may just be unsafe, if anything. I do understand and realize what Lathrup is looking at. I mean, they are a city. They would like to have an identity. They like to have a downtown of some sort. And it's a nice thing to look at. And I talked to their planner or something like that, the same one they did the 9 Mile Road there, and you're going to do, I don't know what the village was called at 9 Mile Road and by Levy School, but, you know, but then it came up that in the middle of 9 Mile Road with the traffic there, it wouldn't be possible to put a village in the middle of it, be like a snake eating a frog and have the digestion both ends. So, you know, I mean, it doesn't work out. So I'd like to have something between us, some kind of agreement before a lot of money is being spent by the agencies, including ourselves, and to make sure that, that whatever we plan, the funding source would run parallel to it, so that we could see it. The way it's going to go, I believe, in, is that we're going to create something by 2014, and one or two things are going to happen. One of the cities is not going to like it and prolong it again, or there's not going to be funding. And like I said, I think that we all have to get together and come up with what we all agree to and run parallel to this 2014 and try to get funding and steer that to a date certain that would been the same as our plan. And I just am concerned that, you know, it's going to be like I-6 96. You know, everything was going to be planned and then replanned and then mediated, and after 100 years, you might see something. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm just saying that's the way it looks. We have several communities involved, and we have separate attitudes of what Southfield Road should be. And I'm not saying anybody's wrong. I'm just trying to say that we all better get on the same ship, or it's not going to happen. You know, I mean, that's the way it's going now. I don't think it'll ever be that serious. You know, I think Southfield, as far as I'm concerned, Southfield pressed something to move it from 12 Mile Road to 14 and get that done with some kind of a boulevard planning and do a nice landscaping plan, and because we have some vacant spaces that should be developed, and we need revenue. I mean, it's getting to the point now where we have to start redeveloping our city, and because it's going through a transitional period, and we better face up to it. And so, anyway, that's just my comment. And I'd like to see somebody kind of weigh in on that.
Ms. Seymour was next, then Mr. Mueller,
and Mr. Thomas. Thank you, Tim. Does anybody know roughly the width of this room? I know it's far less than 60 feet. The idea of a 60-foot median on Southfield Road, to me, is the most ridiculous thing I can imagine. I mean, who came up with that? Was that the Road Commission's suggestion?
Originally.
For what purpose?
Move traffic.
The paved surface that's out there right now, from one edge to the other, is 60 feet wide. So that would be the width of the median. There would be two lanes outside of that.
So they'd be creating additional widening. So that would
elimination of green space.
An elimination of a few storefronts. That's horrible.
They do have the right that's already. It wasn't going to take an additional property. We've got those businesses along Southfield Road. A lot of their parking is in the public right of
the
problem that the Road Commission has allowed. The cities, our city has certainly allowed it, and it would cease to exist.
But the 60-foot median, to me, is the most absurd thing I can imagine. I'm sorry I hadn't heard that before today. A lot of other things, but not the width of the median. And I've seen drawings of it, but it never, you know, that's horrendous. That's just not necessary. I can't even, I mean, if you want to create something that we could not ever agree on, that's a good way for them to just sabotage the whole project. I'm not suggesting they are doing that, but going there, who knows. That's something I think if we could narrow that down, you don't need more than 20 feet. If that, you could have a 15-foot median and do a nice job. I'm appalled. But I do agree that we all should, and I believe can, come to an agreement, because we'll get nowhere with the Road Commission if we don't. And I frankly, I don't think it's that difficult for us to do. to get out on site? I really don't. I mean, they're jerking us around based on our, you know, kind of like, well, you, this one with this and the other one with this. I don't think it's going to be that difficult once we get some kind of a group together to go out and look on site and see what we're talking about. Because I think they're playing us, to be honest with you. I don't like it at all.
Mr. Mueller.
A couple things. I wanted to, I guess, clarify one thing, that we really are talking about parking on Southfield Road. I believe it was only showed on access roads that parallel Southfield Road, so we had that off of the road. So obviously it's going to be dangerous.
Did you hear that?
There's no parallel parking on Southfield Road. It was on access roads that paralleled Southfield. This is how we showed it. It's like one of the lower concepts there. And the other thing I would echo is, actually, Don does make a very good comment in terms of, if we're going to get federal funding, we ought to have a unified, hopefully some kind of unified goal here, because goodness knows when that funding is going to come around. They're told us as soon as, I guess, the first phase would be 2019 now, is what we're looking at. So when they're ready to go, hopefully we're all going to be ready to go. So we do need to get together.
Well, we also need dashboard cooperative credits. So this is something we could use for the governor's dashboard. Ms. Maria Thompson?
Yeah. Call me Maria. I absolutely agree. I see absolutely no reason why we can't come together. When Beverly set forth their notion, I see that meshing nicely with what we were talking about. I'm just not clear on what Southfield's vision is, because Southfield has that first, you know, bite when coming off the freeway. And then we have Lathrup, and then we have Southfield again. So I don't know that I've heard or really understood what Southfield's vision going through that area is. I don't know if the plan...
Well, our planner spoke to you a little bit about traffic calming, but and we have talked about immediate. We want a sense of place. And like you, we find Southfield Road is so wide, it's the bottom.
Right, and it makes no sense. We go from freeway to two-lane, 25-mile-an-hour residential in a space of a couple of miles. And there has to be some transition along that way. I'm not sure how to do that. I'm not sure what our vision from doing that is, but I mean, I think we all agree. We go from freeway to 25-mile-an-hour residential in a span of a couple of miles, and we need to address how to do that.
Good evening again. I think we all share a common goal that 60 feet wide median is way too large. And we're probably in the range of 20 to 30 feet, what makes sense. We also have several of our long-time businesses that have parking in the right-of-way. And by enlarging the right-of-way, we're therefore stripping the parking, and we're putting them out of business.
Sure. But can you really just delineate for me, what do you see coming off the freeway up until Lincoln, that first transition coming off the freeway, and then, you know, how do you envision that phasing of that freeway to 25-mile-an-hour residential?
Right. Well, I think the key point for us is that, for one thing, I really understand that the Road Commission's concern about safety, because if anyone's driven on Southfield Road or tried to make left turns out of those businesses, you feel like you're taking your life in your hands sometimes when you're doing that. So, in general, we've been in support of a median, always saying a smaller median. A lot of emphasis we're putting on the pedestrian walkability, and so that people can safely cross and have that.
Where do you see that starting?
I think that we really want that for the entire stretch through the city of Southfield.
Coming right off the freeway or at 10 mile or?
Well, I think with that freeway being divided, it seems like it would lend itself pretty easily to having a median for
then
that entire
right
stretch.
The freeway.
Right. Because even for pedestrians crossing the road there, that may not be as high of a pedestrian area, but it's still nice to have that safe haven.
Right. I mean, I can think of that area between 10 mile and the freeway kind of like a wasteland. I mean, there's nothing you can do, you know,
right,
traffic-wise, going in and turning or doing anything.
In the nicest sense of the
way. Well, it would be so difficult to it's a locate?
Right, it would certainly improve the look of things to have some extra green space. So a lot of these plans, you know, this is altogether, this is 160 foot right away.
Mm-hmm.
In general, that's what. Okay. And that's what they are. We're trying to encourage more green space on the outsides too. So, you know, sidewalks and then have a green belt so that we can plant trees and
okay.
I think
so
overall
you envision
to look at
a median from the freeway continuing all the way
to 13
Yeah. I mean, and if there's a reason or one of the communities north of 13 mile don't want to see the median that far, you know, they can always, they taper down. If someone's vision is a little different than mine, I mean, you can, they can change it from one stretch to another as long as the traffic flow allow that. And we're really going to be relying on these traffic studies to see which of these options are feasible. I mean, we can have these grandiose ideas, but if it doesn't work to get the capacity of cars through, then the Road Commission is never going to buy it. So.
Yeah. I was just going to say, I think if you look at South 11 down to the lodge and the Southfield Freeway, it's kind of a speedy corridor through there, but don't you have an issue down around 10 Mile where you have there's a population that needs to be, that does a lot of walking and whatnot, and really if it's treat that like a pedestrian corridor, how do you deal with that as you're having that freeway transition area through there that has to be very walkable? That'll be a challenge, I would think.
I mean, the pedestrians will probably still be, I mean, they're going to be forced to cross at the light. I mean, we have light signals there. And if there's, if we've got a gap of a place that needs a signal, you know, between if it's a whole mile of road or it's a half a mile and it's just too far, and that's something that we would be pushing for. The Orthodox Jewish community down there is very large, so we do have a lot of pedestrians still down there.
And I'd just like to add that the median option does provide a safe harbor for pedestrians who can cross a couple lanes of traffic in one direction, then wait until the timing is right to cross the other. So we're trying to find some balance there between the aesthetic appeal, the traffic calming, and getting our pedestrians across safely.
All right, Mr. Moss and Mr. Professor.
Yeah, on board three, somebody explain that. I see four different iterations of what a median could look like. Who's designed that? Is that, are those standards that each of our three communities should be designing our plans around? Are some more realistic than others, or are all of these feasible at certain points of the Southfield corridor stretch? Because I do see, you know, an option where it looks like traffic is opposing, but there are side lanes off, which could fit into a Lathrup Village plan of you know, slowing down for parking in front of some of the businesses there, but there's also options that look kind of identical to Telegraph, you know,
right,
which would be a different type of.
As Cheryl had indicated, there's seven different cross sections. These are four that Southfield would like to pursue in further, depending on where along the Southfield Road. So we've narrowed it down from seven to four, and there's pros and cons for each of these. So we're working towards some type of consensus, as well as getting input from Lathrup Village and Beverly Hills to make sure that the transition works. So these are our top four of the seven with some modifications needed.
Okay. And secondly, we've been talking about, you know, we don't want a maximum of 60 feet for a median, but what's a minimum? Because at some point you have to have enough room for a truck to make a turnaround. So we have to have some sort of, you know, indicator of what we are looking at in terms of a minimum. Can't just be, you know, 10 feet. There has to be some sort of safe way for a truck to make a turnaround.
Thank you for mentioning that. The 60-foot wide median comes from FHWA standard for being able to turn a semi-truck. We call it a WB60. That's the standard. That's their Cadillac, if you will. There are ways to narrow that down, but it just has to be mitigated. How are we going to accommodate commercial traffic in this corridor? So that's where that 60 comes from, if you're wondering about that. There's no overrunning curbs at that rate. Your radius and your median crossovers are wide enough that it can accommodate a large semi-truck vehicle. But there are alternatives. I mean, that's their standard. That's footprint that they start from. And it's up to us to show alternative designs that will work, that will still be safe and accommodate commercial vehicles. And that's where we're at right now, looking at exactly how narrow can we get that median down to. And maybe we have designated crossovers that are signed for commercial trucks, that's where they'll have to make that movement. Those are some of the alternatives we're looking at.
I think we also have to think about fire trucks,
yeah,
in particular, safety vehicles.
So I think, you know, I don't know if this is being done already on the steering committee or whatnot. You know, I think the next logical step is that there are 7 iterations of what traffic flow could look like in all the lane breakdowns. You know, we really have to pick our top amongst us and see what's realistic along that stretch from community to community, from Mount Vernon all the way up to 14 miles.
Mr. Precaution?
Yeah, I was just going to mention that some time ago when we bought the Nate David, that was going to be a art center. And at that time, LTU did a plan for that, which would put islands of landscaping down Southfield Road from Expressway down to 10 Mile Road. And both would be, the islands would be planted and the sides would be planted with trees. And in each office, front of each office building, there would be a sponsored piece of art. And that would be their art corridor. It was a real neat plan. However, it didn't come to fruition. But if you look at the way they had designed the roadway, it did make sense at that time that you had your interruptions with islands where trucks could go into that little lane and do their turning at different places along that stretch between the expressway and highway. So I think the engineering could do some engineering to make that happen at certain places. But, you know, I think the landscaping and having a smaller median did work there with the islands. But I agree with the individuals who are talking about coming together on one concept, at least what we're talking about, the median, you know, what we're really going to do with the median, that'd be one thing. And I think Jeremy made a little point there. That would be something you could start out with and then go from there, and then each community could have an idea of what they particularly want, and they'd all get together and decide. But I agree with Jeff. If we don't decide on something, we're not going to get funding. We're just wasting our time.
Next I have Ms. Seymour and then Ms. Rowell and Ms.
Thank you, Ken. talking about the median, Greenfield Road was, when 696 went through, Greenfield Road was widened. And there's a median there now that was not there before. And it's a narrow median. We have big trucks. We have fire trucks. I live right in that area. And I'm there every single day. We have fire trucks of all types. We have big trucks. Big delivery trucks. And we do have a shopping center on the Oak Park side, so all the parking is in the shopping center. However, we have big trucks coming through there. I would suggest anyone that's concerned about that maybe go over and look at it. It's a narrow median. People are safe. It doesn't go all the way down Greenfield, but people, you know, it's a kind of a safety place for people to go that are crossing. And I'd suggest that those who haven't seen that might want to go and look at it and see how it could be, you know. It's very relative, I think, to what we're talking about. It does the job. It could be a little wide. It's a narrow one, but it works for safety. I think we'd want something maybe a little wider on Southfield Road in certain areas, but not a lot. You can beautify it. It only holds one strip of trees down the middle. It doesn't have a lot of planting. It doesn't have all the stuff we'd like to see on Southfield Road, but it's worth taking a look at. I really think that we could come up with a very nice plan without this 60-foot...
Medium. Chris?
As part of the EA process, I have requested that all communities take a look at the alternatives and put together a formal position
what you would like to see within the corridor. The planning board is actually currently working on that with our planners with LSL. They're going to be reviewing, I think, a first draft of that at their meeting later this month. As a suggestion, I would be happy to share that draft. The planning board would look at it, and obviously the council would look at it. I would just make a suggestion. I'd be more than happy to share that draft with Mr. Crow and Mr. Schreff, also with the Lathrup Village and their administration, to give you an idea of what it is that we're looking at. Because clearly we're going to be focused on the area north of 13 mile. But I think that might be the opportunity for all the communities to come together to mesh those position statements together. And I think I'd certainly be happy to work with the communities to, if we can, to put one statement together that all three sign off on to say, this is our joint vision of Southfield Road. I wouldn't take the liberty of just trying to decide on behalf of the Planning Board of the Village Council what's going to be most appropriate for the Southfield Road and 696 interchange, but be happy to sign off on a joint document for the communities who were involved in that made that decision, and you can also take a look at what our position was on 13 mile corridor and the north of 13 mile corridor. Now, we'll just throw that out as a suggestion. I'll be happy to share what we're working on with your board, and maybe, hopefully, maybe all three administrations or all three planners or however we decide to go forward to work on a joint statement for all of us to put together in time to meet the EA committee's timeline. Okay.
Do members of the councils drive this stretch of road during rush hour?
Oh, yes, every day.
Okay, so everybody's familiar with the volume of traffic. As you, the farther you go north, you reach destinations. The traffic flow count will support that. It drops off substantially. So when you talk about different areas, it really follows the flow of the traffic and the volume of the traffic that's moving from the end of the Lodge or Southfield Freeway, where the Lodge come together there, up to 696. There's a large group of people that are passing through. And that happens in all the communities for a while. But there's a large volume of that traffic that's going to get on to 696, both at evening or in the morning, coming the other way or whatnot. And when you talk about these different looks and feels, I think you're going to come up with three or four different ones, maybe one for each community. That doesn't mean we have to come up and agree to the four necessarily. We have to come up with the agreement for what supports your community and what supports the other communities. We don't even have to agree with the other communities as long as it moves the traffic and the road commission is up for that. There might be some where within Lathrup Village and Southfield where you guys go from Southfield to Lathrup to Southfield. So there's some agreement that has to happen there. But when you look at the volume of traffic that's moving, what they call these deceleration lanes, where you can have some off-street parking still, works pretty well. And it actually works very well in all of the communities. Because if you look at the Southfield area, where you're going from the freeway up to the other freeway, from M39 up to 696, there's a large group of people that want to get there as fast as possible and as safely as possible, and that's the goal. However, there are businesses there that you want to promote and you want to have viable that helps your community. Well, if you look at a deceleration lane where people can pull off safely, traffic goes on, when you have a median there so that they aren't trying to cross over at the same time, they go to the next crossover point when they come out of the deceleration lane and get back onto the traffic flow. Those are things you have to look at, and I know you have. I can tell it in designs. And the same thing happens in Beverly Hills. As we go farther north, when traffic volumes are less, traffic speeds can also decrease somewhat. It's just a natural tendency. And especially when you get up into Birmingham, where for some, I'm guessing, I don't know how much input Oakland County Road Commission had with the city of Birmingham with Southfield Road north of 14 mile, but to think you go from a 45 mile an hour area to a 25 mile an hour area is kind of crazy. And then the other thing is, when you go to a side street, and other roads that are the major cross streets have to also be redesigned to carry the traffic flow. Because when you go to 14 mile, I think 14 mile only has a speed of 35 miles an hour. Maybe 40, I don't know if it's that. But all you're doing is getting your traffic back up quicker. So if you go over to Woodward, you're backing up all the way to Greenfield or past Greenfield. So great, you know, you got 45 miles an hour, you just get to go sit somewhere else. So we have to think of all these areas and design those, but I think we have to be, one, realistic, at the
the same time, we have to understand that each community is different. I see that tonight, and I think we're doing a good job. But at the same time, I think we can accept other people's visions, even if it's not ours, because it works for their community and will keep the flow of traffic going and allow them to develop their corridor. And that's what we're hoping to do.
I appreciate those comments. That I don't see a whole lot of disagreement on what any of us are saying tonight. I guess my question is, where do we see the other communities maybe being a hindrance to doing what we want to do? You know, because we're all saying the same things. I think we're all agreeing. What, I don't know, preventing us from getting there? Mm-hmm. What is, you know, does somebody think somebody else's vision isn't compatible with?
If I could just say, I go back to 2004, how did the whole project get stopped? Because Lathrup Village wanted to have their thumbprint on that development, which is their right, but I'm constantly told Lathrup Village stopped it. And one of the reasons why I'm so passionate about this meeting, Lathrup Village, Beverly Hills, and Southfield, and I do agree that we all have our needs and we all have our vision. Are we now, when we get to this Fonzie, after we complete this thing, are we going to move forward, or can someone say, that's not what I want, so I'm not going to participate? That's my fear.
I hear what you're saying, but I don't think that I think there's a commitment here. What I'm hearing is it's a good rhetorical question. Mr. Zorn, I'm going to let you chime in here. Then Mr.
I just wanted to comment. There's the statement that Lathrup Village's process stopped this. I actually believe, from my conversations with the Road Commission, that for a number of years the Road Commission felt they did not have to do the environmental impact statement. When I came on board in 2008, I sat through 2 years of meetings with people saying we don't need to do it. And then later on, there's this, because of the size of the project, we knew we do need to do it. And so I know there's been a conflicting statement here, but that's, I know from a half dozen plus meetings with the Road Commission, that's what my understanding of it. I also just want to comment, we're talking about a $36 to $45 million project. The mayor and other elected officials in Southfield have had me say this. We know this. The last federal aid committee from the Road Commission had about $18.5 million to spend, just under $200 million in projects. This project is never going to qualify under the existing formula. I think this needs to move through the environmental impact statement process, come together with a finalized vision that respects each community's vision to do what they need to do. Then we need to probably, through some type of association, engage a federal lobbyist. This is going to be, I can tell you, Southfield has submitted, I have submitted on an annual basis a federal earmark to either Levin or Stabenow, as well as Sandy Levin. We haven't submitted any recently, but if this project is going to move forward. The mayor's last trip to D.C., I think it was her last trip in January, she took a two-pager to meet with folks in transportation, and we were using a $45 million number from 9 mile to 14 mile. I think we've got to finish the planning process and immediately begin focusing on the budget process. Final comment, the current budget process will do 1 mile at a time. And we're talking, Southfield has already approved engineering from 12 to 13 mile. And even though, and I've scratched my head, they actually asked us to go through the Road Commission, go through engineering, even though the environmental impact statement's done. There's a lot of disconnects in this process. Southfield Council approved it. We know it's not going anywhere. I have said to my council, I believe a lot of this is a bluff tactic for us to say we don't have the local match. And the local match is going to be on a $45 million project between all of us, $6 to $9 million. So we've got to figure that part out as well. The last point I want to make is this concept of doing a mile at a time. will really kill us. If you want to make it difficult on our businesses, I saw what Telegraph did at 12 Mile and how MDOT broke it down. We've got to go in and you go northbound 1 year or southbound, and it's all done from the freeway up to 14 Mile. That's the best way to minimize disruption. And I will tell you, from my last community I worked with, MDOT said, oh, it couldn't be done, but I was able to go from I-75 to 94 1 year. So we've got to hold their feet to the fire on that. But it begins with that collective, unified vision from everyone at this table.
Mr. Frazier, second.
Yeah. I agree with the folks that have already said that we need to really pay attention to the borderlines between each of the communities. What's going through my head is, whatever kind of design we come up with, it has to, we have to put all the ingredients in it so that it works when it's all over with. And one of the things that troubles me, or it's a question on my part, is I understand that Lathrup wants to have created downtown, which means that someone drives to Lathrup, parks their car, and gets out and does their shopping. Is it realistic to expect a mother or a parent and small children to walk from one side of Southfield Road to the other? Can it be designed with that in mind so that they'll go through with the amount of traffic that needs to go through and not design it so that it blocks traffic, because that's not going to work either? So that would be a real concern if that's part of the plan. I'm not real sure that I would be willing to take my grandchildren across Southfield Road back and forth to do shopping on both sides of the street. Also, on Woodward Avenue, the deceleration lane, the parking is adjacent to Woodward Avenue, and I drive that on a regular basis. And I can tell you, when traffic is heavy, folks have a terrible time getting out of that deceleration lane or that side road back into the flow of traffic, because everybody says, let the other guy let him in. And I've seen people wait there for a long time before they get in. So that has to be taken into consideration too, with the amount of traffic that goes up Southfield Road. And I don't see it getting any less. The other question I'd like to ask to the engineers or whatever, do you have modeling software so that once the design is made, you can take into consideration that people are going to be trying to cross during heavy periods of traffic and light periods of traffic and all that, ever can do it safely?
Yes, we do. It's called Synchro in Sim Traffic. And we recently, approximately 10 days ago, completed that traffic analysis. It's about 400 pages long. And we just submitted it to the Oakland County Road Commission for their initial review. And once they've approved it for distribution, it will be given to each of our steering committee members.
And it takes into consideration foot traffic, bicycle traffic, and the flow of traffic during different periods of time, the light and heavy traffic periods?
Correct. We focus on the highest peak hourly traffic volumes, actually. But it does take into consideration signal timing to accommodate pedestrian crossings, what we call side friction from parallel parking or numerous driveways. We look for ways for access management principles to be incorporated. It's very detailed, quite detailed.
Yeah, 400 pages, I suppose. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Mueller.
I can say one thing we had done, we found out about the 60-foot wide median, is we had our planners go back and develop an access management plan, just like what he's talking about, that you would have a separate road that we got rid of, I don't know, 40 curb cuts, 11, 12 miles, that's a, you know, we get a lot of your accidents. And so, I mean, we were working diligently to kind of come up with alternatives that could work along with the median, but not as wide, so we've done a lot of work there. The other point I wanted to make is that put more cars there.
Ms. Burton?
59 minutes to talk, so I'm a little sad here. I think we should have another meeting possibly with the administrators and the planners to sort of work out the fine details. I think it may be a little bit difficult to do at this meeting because we all have our own, it's our own community, but yet we've got to function as one. So I would suggest, Mr. President, with the other approval for the from the other individuals, we can have another series of meetings with those individuals, the planners and the administrators, to sort of fine-tune the details here. But I do have one question to the administrator from Beverly Hills. We've had a lot of discussion in our city from moving from the pole signs to the garden signs. That's been one of my hot topics for our city because I think you really want to rebrand your city to look good. Communities are doing that, and to hear you say that is really just music to my ears. Is there any way we could possibly get a copy of your ordinance and have us take a look at it? Because we're going to be having those same discussions literally within the next 30 days.
I'd be happy to provide a copy of that, along with our old ordinance, that's kind of redlined, showing you the changes that we made. And I can provide all of that to Mr. Crow and have him provide that to you.
Okay, thank you. Because I think what it'll do is not only are we enhancing Southfield Road, but the community will begin to flow together and look together. So I really would appreciate that. Thank you.
I just want to think of a three, it seems like we could go on for hours with the different details. And what I would look for, I mean, I think this has been very helpful, but what I would look for is for a subcommittee of our experts to get together and help for purposes of getting the funding and working together, give us a list of the things we need to agree on. Because I think there's a lot of things we don't, aesthetically and things like that, we all want our identity, but you know, let's narrow it down by what do we have to agree on, and that's where we can start our focus.
We're thinking along the same lines. Ms. Kelly, I've discussed this with our planner, what's our next step? It's important to have this airing of where we are today. Obviously, there's a lot of work still going on. This is not something that's going to be resolved anytime real soon. But I think the final comment I would add is that I think it behooves us to have some kind of unity in the corridor so that it has a sense of place. It's an attraction that, you know, people come to Southfield Road to shop, for entertainment. All around us, other communities have developed corridors that are highly successful, and we could do it here. If we made a greater sense of place, slowed traffic somewhat, had something more attractive than what we've got now, which was really built for car culture, and it's we're looking to the future to change the dynamic. So we will be in touch with everyone regarding next steps, and I personally have seen and discussed this with our planner that we would have some kind of steering committee that perhaps would work with the road commission and the consultants that they're hiring for this feedback. But clearly, we've got a number of meetings ahead before the money's there and action can take place. Final comments, and then we have five or six things on our agenda yet tonight. So, Mayor Lawrence.
Just a closing comment. I just want to go back to the emphasizing that Southfield Corridor. I really see the benefit of that. And we have a real push in our city for outdoor art, and that would be something we could collaborate on, and that corridor could really be impressive, and we could work together on that. And also, that piece they talked about, a federal lobbyist to help us with this funding, is very important. And if we as a form of consortium that could work on that, it's
going to really change things for our area.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Lamb?
Your place stay diagram here, does this have anything to do with the subject we're talking about here?
Yeah.
I see something here which, well, I have to speak about it, but I can't speak about it tonight.
Okay.
But why was the place down today? Now?
Why was what?
Why was this place before us?
Mr. Crowe wanted to provide a feedback from the March 20th meeting.
That's correct.
We don't want to talk about it now.
He did talk about it.
Yeah. This is just some background information from our workshop. And I'll be happy to talk to you about it in greater detail.
Okay, I'll wait for later.
Okay. And Mr. Patarkin?
I just have to thank Beverly Hills and Lathrup for coming here and setting the agenda. It's very important that we continue to keep the communication gap open and try to get the same results. It's very important that we do something.
And final word, Ms. Seymour.
Thank you, I think that the idea of the identity for each community is a very easy one to solve because you've got the median that can be very different in each community, and that would be make it interesting. So there's different planning, you have your signage, you know, you're entering Beverly Hills or you're entering Lathrup Village. There are lots of things can be done in the median to make them very charming and very identity specific to the community. The challenge is the functionality of each area for each city. That's the technical part. But the beautification and the identity to me is an easy one to solve. I am appreciative of all of you coming, and I think this is something I wish we had done a long time ago. But I think we're thinking in the right direction. It's just how do we solve some of these functionality issues that, especially for Lathrup, I think you've got things that you need. And I think all these things can be done, but maybe not exactly to the extent that everybody wants it. But I see something very beautiful in the future if we are successful. And again, thank you all. Appreciate all the comments and your participation. I'm actually encouraged for the first time.
And thank you, everyone. We really appreciate it. And I speak for myself. You've given me a lot to think about. So it's good to hear rather than the hearsay rather than to hear it directly from all of you. So we're going to take a 5-minute recess, and then we'll reconvene for the rest of our agenda. But thank you and good night.
Guidelines in this grant are complex. The final details were shifting, and they are now finalized, and we're recommending the council declare immediate need to act and approve this item so we can submit the grant in a timely manner.
I understand that the grant application is later this week, next week, April 27th. Is there any discussion from council? Hearing none, then I'll ask for a Rule 10. It's been moved by Ms. Jordan, supported by Mr. Moss, for an immediate need to act. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Let's put the motion on the floor, and then we'll do questions. I need a motion.
I'll make a motion that we approve the authorization for the transportation charter grant.
Moved by Ms. Jordan, supported by Mr. Moss. Discussion, Madam Mayor.
Yes, the application for the grant is made, and if we receive it, does it come back to the council?
Yes. We always bring grants back to council.
Okay, and at that time, then the council will approve the application of it, or is this approval tonight?
It's merely an authorization to apply.
Okay.
We always bring it back.
Okay. And so when you bring it back, you'll see what is the amount of money and how.
Right.
Okay.
In full detail and the amounts of money and the specifics of the plan.
Thank you.
Am I correct that we're asking for one amount, but we may get another?
that correct?
On this particular project?
Yeah.
There are different cycles of this grant, yes.
Okay. All right, any other discussion? Hearing none, then all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Moving on to another grant, similar grant, that, and again, same format, this is approval to apply, authorization to apply for transportation alternative grant, Southfield Village Estates Sidewalk Improvement Project. Well, let's start with, we need a rule count on this as well. So I'll entertain a motion.
Correct. The rule 10 is for the same reasons as given in the other grant.
Right. Same deadline. It's been moved by Mr. Moss, seconded by Ms. Jordan. All those in favor?
Aye.
Rule 10. Opposed? Motion carries. All right. Then let's put this on the floor.
I'll move to authorize the administration to apply for MDOT Transportation Alternatives Program grant for the Southfield Village State Sidewalk Improvement Project.
Support. And it's been moved by Mr. Moss, supported by Mr. Frazier. Discussion.
Yeah, I'd like to have our city administrator explain this to us a little bit. You know, just clarify what's going to happen.
Yes, this item is a grant request that involves $147,657. $95,977 grant amount, match 35% or $51,680. The local, the grant match would come from any combination or among the following items: the Local Improvement Revolving Fund and or the Metro Act, as is allowable under that source, or from the proceeds of a special assessment district established for this purpose. Again, we have a deadline of April 22nd, and so we would like to proceed with this item as written.
Do you have any idea when the grant process would be awarded, when the grant would be awarded? Is this yet this year, or?
I'll defer, I believe, Mr. Crowe can help with that. Or how about Ms. Carlock? Ms. Carlock. Yeah.
Here.
Ms. Carlock is with our Parks and Recreation Department. She has great expertise in writing grants, and she had a key role in putting this item together.
This grant cycle, I think there's four cycles a year, so it's a revolving. So we had a grant that went in December, and we heard in February. So I expect that we would hear, you know, by summer on this one. So that's very fast for one of these grant cycles.
Okay, there's more planning that needs to be done, but all we're doing tonight is just giving you authorization to apply for the grant.
That's right.
Okay.
And we come back with a contract that would be with the granting agency.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Yeah, Mayor?
Yes, and looking at the map, we're applying for this grant. Do we have approval of all the homes in this area to participate?
Through the chair, that would be part of another step if the option were to initiate a special assessment district. Mm-hmm. Also, we do need to meet with the residents, but that would be not necessary to apply for the grant, but is a necessary step in the entire process.
Through the chair, we do have a neighborhood meeting that's being scheduled for next week. We have a number of residents from that neighborhood who are also here in support. We have heard from a number of members over the last year or two about the need and desire to make it more walkable for safe routes to school, as well as on the Sabbath. And we do fully expect to get letters of endorsement and support from the neighborhood. One of the things we will be talking about opportunity to apply for the grant, and we'll be working concurrently with the neighborhood to figure out how to get it financed and how to get it built.
And Mr. While you're there, if there was a special assessment, the grant funds would mitigate some of the cost per resident, correct?
I think through the chair, our deal would be in similar situations would be a 50-50 match, and the grant funds would help reduce that 50% requirement. So I think there would be a significant cost savings to the homeowners. I understand from our city engineer that sometimes these things can be spread out over 10 years, and it'd be a very minimum cost per year for each homeowner, depending on the amount of frontage that they would have. And so we're working on all those areas of planning right now.
And we need a level of participation, 60%?
60%, as you may recall, when the council, if they decide, there's a series of public notices and hearings, and we would need 60% of the affected homeowners to be in favor in order for this to go forward. And that will be another 3-4 month process that we'll be looking at if we get the funding for this project.
Okay. Mr. Picasso?
And Mr. Chairman and Council, I drove that entire district and I had this map to go, and I think that the residents have to be well aware of, you know, when you haven't had a sidewalk and you're planted out there by the right of way, that there's going to be some major disruption to landscaping, and in one area that bushes right down the whole side that have to be removed. There's fire hydrants and sewer covers. I know it's 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, 16, routed around it and go deeper into the residential area. So I just want to be sure that those who are looking at the sidewalk and our engineering staff and staff be really upfront with those people who whose lawns are going to be tore up, because you know, we went through this at 13 Mile in Greenfield, and that was, you know, people were just screaming about the rose bushes were taken out. And I know there's a corner house there at the corner of, let's see, it was Southwood and Sheffield. He's got some nice evergreens there on the corner. He's got wraparound driveway. Those would all have to be removed. So I just, you know, I'm for the project. I just want to make sure that everybody's on board when, you know, and not being told something that isn't accurate. Because, you know, it's always good to do, the city wants to do improvements, we want to have safe streets, but just as long as everybody who's involved in knows, you know, what is going to go on when they disrupt that, that front yard. And so that's just a word of caution. But again, it's up to the residents to petition for it, and then we'll go forward.
I'm sure that'll be part of the neighborhood meeting. Ms. Jordan?
I totally agree with Councilman Sakaki. I do want the residents to be fully aware of what this is going to entail. Now, my question is, if we don't get 60% support, what happens at that time? What happens at that time if the project is not supported by the residents in the community?
It's legal, I'll tell you.
If in fact, through the chair, there is not at least 60% support for an FAD, then that improvement on utilizing FAD funding could not be made. Now you may fund it some other way, but you couldn't take the match and spread it as an FAD.
So that would be where the 60% would come in. Could you finance that match using an FAD?
Okay. I really want to closely watch this, and I know you're meeting with the residents, but until we get the letters and just have full support, we just got to keep our eye on it.
Ms. Seymour?
Thank you. I support applying for the grant. I do have some reservations, though, so I'm going to vote yes with reservations based on the fact that I think there's going to be a lot more expenses and a lot more disruption than I think people are aware of. So, but in terms of applying for the grant, we'll see where that goes.
Well, you know, we have, as always, we have safety on the one hand, we have cost to the homeowner on another, and cost to the city and disruption. So I think the caution that's been expressed around the table this evening is well-founded, we'll look forward to the neighborhood meeting.
Can I just add, I mean, if people want sidewalks and need sidewalks, I support them having sidewalks. We've always, I think, supported completing sidewalks, but there are times when they're far more disruptive and expensive than people recognize, and that's all I'm saying.
Is there any other discussion? If not, we have a motion on the floor to apply for an alternative transportation alternatives program grant for Southfield Village Estates sidewalk improvement. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion nays. Motion carries. All right. We want to move on to item number four, which is I'll call on Mr. Charette, and I think we'll turn it over to Chief Hawkins.
Yes, Chief Hawkins is here to answer any questions you might have. Of course, our ongoing first priority is safety and security. And so what we have before you is an opportunity here to move up some items that were requested in the 13-14 budget. In analyzing that budget, and then also analyzing results for fiscal year 11-12, I am recommending that the items that are outlined be moved into this year's budget and initiated immediately, because they have safety implications to the public, and the affordability is there because in 11-12, this fund, which is a separate operating fund, had revenues in $135,677 greater than their expenditures. So with that, we have the items listed. First being a police dog replacement for the retired police dog that is living happily ever after, right, Chief?
Yes.
With the family, the handler's family. Three laser radar units, forensic investigative equipment for computer crimes unit, media equipment to update our interview rooms, which is required to enhance the video and audio capacities of the department. Surveillance vehicle, which will be acquired under the process that's applicable through the joint efforts of the Southfield Police and the federal agencies involved. And a 3% contingency allowance, which I believe is sufficient in this case because there is flexibility in the pricing of these items. And we can come in within the budget of $91,052. We're asking for a council to approve the appropriate budget adjustment and authorize the city staff to seek bids for this police department equipment.
And you're looking for that for April 22nd, correct?
Correct. All we're looking for at this point is a consensus of council.
Okay.
We'll bring this back for formal action on the 22nd.
And G-Chief, we don't want to steal your thunder, but if there's anything you want to add, overnoting the hour.
Yes, so am I, sir. And through the chair, good evening, council, and Madam Mayor, and city officials, and members of the public. And the items are listed. These are items that are essential to police operations. It will help us to operate more effectively and more efficiently. And I'm here to answer any questions questions that you may have about any of the items on the agenda.
Mr. Moss has been keeping a running list of all of the things that we've done in recent years to support our police department, and I'm going to request that you be sure to add this. You're providing that service.
The most interested party in all that information is present tonight.
Yes, unfortunately.
My question is what are the lifespans of all of these items? How regularly will these things come back? You know, how long do obviously police dog do the loop? I don't know if there's an answer to that, but you know, the laser
raider
units, how long do you...
There's answers to each of them. I just want to say a word, and that's all. Just to say that during the budget process, we keep some various hours, and I just want to say when we came up with this, the response of the police chief and the detail that he brought forth is admirable.
Thank you. And a great question. And starting with the first one, the K-9 units, they have a lifespan of approximately 7 to 8 years. So the one that we just replaced just outlived its lifespan. Our laser radar units, usually they last somewhere in the area of six or seven years as well. The forensic investigative equipment, that's something that should last us a while. For those of you who don't know, we are one of the few police departments in Southeast Michigan that have a computer crimes unit with the capabilities of forensic investigations of particularly cell phones, but also with our computers. And as we all know, you know, we're having incidents with cell phones that are really escalating around the country, and we have a unit that is equipped to handle this emerging trend that we're seeing. The media equipment that you see there, that's something that'll last a while. As Mr. Charette alluded, there is a state law that mandates that all interrogations are videotaped. We're currently in compliance. However, with this new law, we are going to be performing even more of these interrogations. There are some interrogations now that we don't necessarily videotape. But now every single one of them will have to be videotaped. We're going to have state-of-the-art equipment in there, and it will allow us to prosecute these incidents effectively. And the surveillance vehicle, lifespan of probably 4 to 5 years on that as well.
Old equipment is going to be what's that?
And that's handled through the purchasing department.
Okay.
And that, what we do is we make the best use of it, and if it's salvageable, and we either reutilize it or we dispose of it in a method that's most appropriate for the city.
Mr. Lamb.
I remember the time back when we approved the laser program, and part of that laser program was supposed to be when you laser somebody, to call an ambulance.
That's a different thing. This is for speeders.
I know. Did we ever follow that procedure?
Call an ambulance when you taser somebody? Because we know it is dangerous to some people.
Yes, absolutely. Anytime we have a use of force incident that involves a taser or any one of our intermediate weapons, then we seek the appropriate medical attention for the person that was involved.
Appropriate method is an ambulance at the scene?
Correct. If it necessitates medical treatment, then we make sure that we have medical treatment available to the person that's involved.
Well, that doesn't tell me that you,
the only reason I qualify it like that is because not every single incident involving a taser results in injury. Because a lot of times it does, because if there's some penetration of the skin, then absolutely, we make sure that person gets medical attention.
Wait a minute, I have something to tell you. When you taser somebody, you don't get immediate complications. They could have a heart attack later, or something could go wrong with the person's body. So that's why I always said have an ambulance there at any time when you taser somebody.
Absolutely. And again, I qualify it only because if we have a taser incident, let's say that the probes only hit the outer clothing of a person, and there's no penetration, there's no pulse that...
Well, you don't have to see the penetration, but it is there. It could stop the heart. It could do damage. You don't see that.
Yes, correct. So that's why we make sure we have a policy in place that's been reviewed by legal and by medical professionals that make sure that any time we have an incident in which a person is exposed to some type of health risk or anything like that, we make sure that we have appropriate medical attention.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Ms. Lawrence is next.
This is coming out of the law enforcement, drug law enforcement fund. Are these the funds we capture as a result of being involved in drug raids?
Yes, great question. We have two funds. We have an officer assigned to a federal task force and one assigned to a county task force. And these funds are coming from those.
So, My question, I still want to put this on the table, and I'm going to keep saying it until it happens. I'm still waiting for a review of administrative building and providing safety measures in the administrative department. It was my understanding that based on our budget and based on the intent of that funds from this law enforcement budget would be used. And I'm not seeking an answer, but I do want to hear a response. Are we going to do an audit? Are we going to be able to show the council and the city's employees that we have put in place, and I keep asking for this, safety measures for us, surveillance, and to ensure that our building is safe. And I approve everything that we're doing here, and I agree with it, but I am tired of no one responding to the request. And I don't know how many ways I have to say it. So thank you.
I think Mr. Frazier was next.
Yes, a couple of questions. The $7,000, does that include training for the handler, or is that just for the dog itself?
That's just for the dog itself.
It's my understanding that dogs are trained to specific commands from the trainer.
Yes.
And that they're in a language that wouldn't necessarily be known to the person, the perpetrator, so they can call the dog off. You know, some foreign language that's arcane and Aramaic or something.
Yes, sir. There are certain commands that that only the handler can give to the dog, and the dog will respond. Yes.
So that will happen after we get the dog.
Correct. The dog and the handler were trained together. Yes.
Okay.
Sometimes on the front line.
Yes.
The other question I have is not even on this list, but I have a great concern for the amount of shootings that every day that's on the, you turn on the news and there's another shooting someplace where someone goes off the deep end and does some real damage. And I want to make sure that our officers are safe. I know the bulletproof vests have a lifespan, and I don't recall seeing a request to have new vests. And I thought the lifespan was somewhere in the neighborhood of 4 or 5 years. Because it was a body sweat and the whole thing helps break down the material. Are you up to date on the vest, or should we be looking at replacing the vest in a pretty short time?
That's a great question, Councilman Percassi, Councilman Frazier. And yes, we revolve our vests out. I think it's every 3 to 4 years. And you can't use it out of forfeiture because one of the provisions in the forfeiture law is that you can't use forfeiture funds for items that are recurring expenses. And our bullet resistant vests, our body armor, they're recurring expenses for us. So they come out of a line item, out of a general fund, and we make sure that the officers are all up to date with their body armor as well as the other protective equipment that they have.
Huh. That seems kind of odd because I would think that the surveillance automobile would be a recurring. I mean, once one quits working, you get another one, which is, I mean, to me, that's about the same thing. But you know the rules a lot better than I do. The last question that I have is, I was watching on the news the other night, and they had this situation where a truck caught on fire, and they captured it on video, and they said, now you think that we had a camera and crawling around, but what it was is the police officer had a head camera, and it seemed to me that seemed to be a really good piece of equipment for our officers to have. And do we have those, or are you thinking about having them, or what?
The answer is yes and no. We tested and evaluated those about a year and a half ago, and we had the officers test them for about 6 months or so. Different officers, but we thought it was a great idea as well. But in theory, it is, but in practice, we found difficulties. First, it's the view, the camera view. You know, when you have it post, you know, when it's fixed to it, because where it was fixed to, you know, either the eyeglasses or around the ear of the officers. And so when they're turning, it's, you know, the point of view was just, for evidentiary purposes, it just didn't help us out a whole lot. And also, it was just uncomfortable for the officers. You know, the officers already have a lot of equipment, and, you know, and just to have something else affixed to their ear or their fall cap or their glasses, it was just uncomfortable.
Okay.
So we tested it, and it just was something that didn't work out for us.
Okay. That's right.
Starting with Ms. Seymour, I'd like to go down the row here. Do we have consensus to put this on the agenda for April 22nd, Ms. Seymour?
Yes.
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 All right, we have seven yeses on a consensus.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Asking about whether or not the availability of bullets and proper arms for our police department.
And the answer to that question is police departments across the country are dealing with this issue because ammunition is being hoarded by private individuals as well as corporations and other folks. And so we're like regular consumers. It's the first part of the answer to your question. Now, the second part is that we foresaw this months ago, and we anticipated a shortage of ammunition. We understood that we still have to train our officers. It's a very important part of risk management. And so we started, stockpiling, if you will, the necessary ammunition for our officers so that not only would we have the ammunition for them out in the field, but we'd have enough for training purposes as well. So, in fact, I just had a conversation a couple of days ago with my training officers that they're still in this area. And they've assured me that we're okay right now. We just ordered a large shipment of the necessary ammunition, and we anticipate that the supply will start to open up again within the next 5 to 6 months, and we'll be well. We should be okay then, but we'll make sure that we make the necessary orders at that time as well.
What's happening to the price?
What's happening to the price of?
marketplace, they're tripling.
Because
I buy them.
I'm being told that the price is not necessarily the issue right now, and we don't see them taking advantage of the issue, but certainly supply is an issue, and we're prepared to deal with that.
All right. Anything else? If not, I would like to, before we move on to the next item, is there a consensus to refer to the police department a security study of the administrative portion of City Hall?
Yes, I would be in favor of this.
You know, there times are changing, so I wouldn't be opposed to a study. I mean, just to see where we are and what we can do to improve.
I had suggested to the city administrator that we have a crime prevention bureau, and they're experts at this. We don't need to go outside and spend money on this, but some recommendations from the crime prevention bureau of the council. I support that. Ms. Seymour, anyone else?
I would like to say something.
Yeah.
I'm concerned about our front lobby and our other entrances. I don't know if we have cameras. Some people told me we do have cameras. I'm not aware of that, but I think that that's something we should be looking at. But if you have cameras, you got to have somebody monitoring them.
Correct.
So that would be my concern. Audrey doesn't have a buzzer at her console to even, you know, ring for help, I'm told. So I think it's worth looking at. I don't think that we should become a fortress, but I do think might be some areas that we want to do something beyond what we're doing.
Well,
for example, Ken, if I may interrupt.
Yeah.
When people come in to most buildings, they have to go to check to the desk and say who they're going to see. People walk in that we don't even know, walk in, we don't know where they're going. You know, the court has some control, and I think we need to be a little more aware of who's coming into our building.
Well, I would just add that I agree with you, and also, what are we going to wait? Too much stuff has happened in other places to ignore this. So
right.
I'm looking for one more person to agree to this so that we can make it a referral. All right, we have two more.
Thank you very much. Wolf.
All right, we have a referral to the city administration and police chief.
As that comment, when you hit the switch the other day, and we had immediate backup. We had two officers, it seemed like in a second.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, in other words, it isn't that we are unprotected now, it's just a matter of hitting the right button
right. When
you need it.
Mm-hmm.
Know where they are.
Okay, thank you for that. Moving along, next on our agenda is, in your packet, I am requesting a meeting, a study session for April 29th. We've got a lot of feedback on signs. And our city attorney and our building department tells us they will be ready on April 29th to bring this back. You recall we did a lot of work with it in the fall, and two subcommittees of council reviewed the recommendations. And then since then, in our joint meetings, we've gotten feedback from the DDA, from Northland, from the Planning Commission, and the City Center Advisory Board about building signage. So I would like to have a study session without further delay, and our staff is ready to bring this back on April 29th. So I'm looking for Rule 10 to, and we have a couple of other things, I think, in the works for that evening. Some recommendations, perhaps, from Neighborhood Services. But at any rate, I need a Rule 10.
For Rule 10.
It's been moved by Mr. Percassi, supported by Ms. Jordan. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we meet schedule a meeting in regards to the signage ordinance.
And while we're on schedule,
excuse me, 1 minute though. Does it include ground signs?
I
that seems to be something that
I'll defer to our attorney, Ms. Ward.
We never sensed a real consensus on where council wanted to go with that distinction between going to just the garden ground signs or the pole signs. One of the things we talked about was maybe at least reducing, going forward, the height of the pole signs. When Ed Gardella had brought in, back when we were over in the library, the study session, a photograph of a pole sign, it was a much more limited in height pole sign, and there seemed to be some agreement among certain council people that was probably acceptable. So we certainly can still look at that. I mean, we've been doing this whole sign ordinance kind of in stages anyway, so we could bring the electronic signs and the additional wall signs for the businesses in the high-rises on the 29th. And then if council were so inclined, we can then go back and look at, if the direction is, you know, you want to prohibit pole signs in the future, obviously we could do that and go to garden ground signs.
Why don't we take the 29th to kind of get a consensus from council where we are on the pole sign versus garden ground
issue. I will let Ed know that.
You don't have to have something exactly any more prepared on that, but we could have that discussion that evening.
Right.
All right.
And it would be good if we could have a copy of Beverly Hills' current ordinance.
I have a note. I'm going to get that right away.
Include it within the packet that night?
Yeah.
Okay.
And Mr. Wells, after the meeting, or after the recess, told me he'd get that over. Yes, Mr. Fraser.
We have a meeting on the 22nd, right?
Yes. Yes, we do.
Why are we making this a rule 10?
It was out of deference to everyone so that they would schedule it. I've had some trouble scheduling the meeting.
All right.
And I thought if we did this, we did just debate it in the Council of Presidents, and I said, you know, why don't we just put it on the agenda tonight so that everybody has that date on their calendar. It is the fifth Monday of the month, and traditionally we have it met on the fifth Monday. That's the reason. Now, Mr. Charette has a request. Thank you. Too many questions. Before we get to Mr. Charette, all those in favor of adding the meeting of the 29th, a COW meeting, six of the thing
I.
We have a rule 10. Do I hear an aye?
Aye.
Yay. The motion carries. We're meeting on the 29th at 7 p.m.
I have an economic development initiative item that I would like to ask. This has to do with BASF and an agreement we have with them, and also a grant opportunity. If you want further detail, Fred, you're all over this one, aren't you? In fact, I know you are, because we talked about the BASF a few times. But what we would do is we have done some important work on this, and we would like to move it along. So I'm asking if a committee of the whole can be scheduled before the meeting on the 22nd, and then if there is consensus on this item, we'd like to place it on the agenda for action on the 22nd. So I'm asking for a COW at 5:30 on the 22nd.
Again, I need a rule 10 for that.
Number 10.
It's been moved by Mr. Moss and supported by Ms. Jordan. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I need a motion.
Move to schedule a COW meeting on April 10th at 5:30.
Support. It's been moved by Mr. Mott, supported by Mr. Frazier. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carried. All right.
Thank you.
Now we have one more item to. We now have a complete contingent of council here. I'm asking for a reconsideration of scheduling a visioning session. This is not a budget session. This would simply be to put some things on the table as to what our council priorities for the next year. And we have no date in mind, but we are ready to go. As we were ready over a month ago. Ms. Seymour, you have your hand up?
Yeah, I did. The last time that you talked, you planned about trying to do this, you scheduled it to be conducted by a city planner.
Right.
That's right. I have a problem with that. We are the board of directors, and he is our employee. And I do not think it's appropriate that he lead us to any kind of a visioning session. In all sense, sir, but I think it's inappropriate. What I would agree to and approve of, we have a strategic plan. And we have a long report that Mr. Charette made of all the things that we've done. And I think it would be appropriate for us to look at this. And we have a lot of goals in here. See what we've done, what we need to do, what we might want to add, and let Mr. Charette conduct it. I know I suggested that the last time we discussed this, that we might want to bring in the person that did it. Ran as soon as we began, Mr. Schoonett, that Mr. Craig is not fond of him. I thought he did a good job, but we could do it with Mr. Charette. Bring this up to date. And then also go through the governance side. There's some things in here that we're supposed to be doing that we're not doing. So I think that would be appropriate, but I would prefer that we either have we let Mr. Schoonett or preferably Jim Charette.
Mr. Percossi.
Mr. Chairman, I just think that we have to come together to discuss the city and where we're headed. And I think it's very important that we know that so that we can put time frames on our decisions so that they just don't wander off into wonderland, that they actually are executed. And so I am for a session that would be geared for that. As far as Terry and I have respect for my colleague, but I sat through the City Center program that Terry did, and it was more or less like a visioning, or at least to find out where they were at. And I found that very rewarding. It got business people to talk about shortcomings and their wishes and wants and not wants. And I just thought it was, in a short period of time, done very professionally, and I got a lot of knowledge out of it from what the people who were in that room, the people who have a vested interest in their office buildings, were saying. And so I think that there's nothing wrong with one of our staff people who has done it before and could do it. You know, it's up to council to buy it or not buy into it, you know. But I just think that it's long in coming forward and we should do it. And like I said, I don't know if Terry passed that out. Did council get copies of the City Center program that you conducted?
Part of the discussion that the board members brought up at our joint meeting, they didn't actually get a copy of it yet because it hasn't been approved yet. It's going to be discussed tomorrow night by the board, and then we'll release it.
Yeah, because that was really eye-opening. You know, and I think you got to some real serious things.
Through the chair, I don't see a conflict here because I'd be glad to organize this effort. As we did to put together the booklet, but the booklet was put together with more than 20 people in the room, and everyone was chipping in. So I would think that this would be a collaborative team effort, and Mr. Krogh would have a role to play in that, and especially the tax base is so important. We need input from people with planning expertise and community development
assist the mayor and the council in setting their priorities for the year. That's how I'd see it.
Okay, the order now is Mr. Moss, Mr. Lance, Ms. Seymour.
Yeah, I would support scheduling it. I would support having Gary facilitate or have a larger role. I think, you know, I don't want to cede any power of the council to give him direction or to give him guidance, but I think it's almost like when we had our city center advisory board joint meeting or the planning commission joint meeting. I think we need to have a back and forth with Gary having an active role, because we need to hear some of the things that he brings to the table in terms of his experience with working with the developers that are interested in Southfield, so we can engage more directly one-on-one. I don't want to say, you know, we're ceding any power of this council to make our proper decisions, but, you know, if half is prologue, I think the most beneficial meetings we've had since I've been on board have been the last several, where we've engaged in dialogue and had that discussion. So, you know, if it can go anything like the last several meetings have been, I would love to see, you know, an open exchange, a back and forth, and I think that Terry's the right person in the city to facilitate that.
Okay, Mr. Lance?
It's a good idea, but I would like the administrator or the budget part of the administrator to be a part of that meeting, because Mr. Crowe does make a very fine presentation, but it's all, as I see it, fantasy so far. We don't have money for it. So that's where the budget guy comes in. So he should be a part of that, and which would enable us to ask him, well, Mr. Charette, what is this going to cost you? Money? When are we going to get money for all that? So he has a part to play in this, too. So I'd suggest you both get together and collaborate. Right.
Ms. Seymour?
I didn't say anything about him not participating. But when this was first planned, he was the person selected to lead this. And I remember the first one we had when he did this whole project, when we went in and put the little sticky dots up on the board, and this was a visioning session. Again, the city center is an advisory board, and he is a liaison to this, to the advisory board. I do not object to anyone participating in this, but it should not be led by Mr. Crowe, who is our employee, and I strongly object if that's the direction that we're going in.
Ms. Jordan.
I see the visioning session as setting the vision for Southfield in the future. And I believe that the plan has a part to that piece, because development is one piece of the city. But I think the bigger picture are the neighborhoods, our revenue, our employees. It's a big picture. So I think this really, my opinion, it should be headed up by the city administrator, and then those that he would want to, those team members that he would want to have at the table to help facilitate where we're going. So I do not agree that Mr. Crowe is the person to head this up, because we're looking for the future. We're not just looking at business development. We're looking at the entire city of Southfield. We're looking at communities, we're looking at revenue, we're looking at processes, we're looking at setting a vision for Southfield in the future. And I would expect our city administrator to be that individual to lead the charge. If he wants to add other people to the team, that's great, but I think he should be the person to lead the charge.
Mr. Frank.
Yeah, this is beginning to sound like Congress. We're supposed to be professionals, and Terry is a professional, and what we're looking for are the people that have the skills to do the job so that we can move forward. I hear the undertones of personalities, and I don't have any problem with an employee of mine that has the right skills to be the facilitator of whatever the project that we're going to take on. I would rather have that than do the protocol, well, this has got to be the city administrator. If the city administrator has the skill, that's fine. If they then we need to have someone that does have a skill. Terry has a skill. We need a job done. If we're professionals, we can accept that and move on. And to make a big deal out of it is, as far as I'm concerned, it's just ludicrous.
I'm hearing that we have four members in support of having Mr. Crowe lead the discussion.
Either way, it'll be a team effort.
It'll be a team effort. I hear Mr. Percossi, Mr. Moss, myself, and Mr. Frazier. So I think we need to move on. Now we get to the date of this. I'm sorry, Ms. Lawrence. He's already done a lot of work, a whole book that Ms. Seymour Wigger.
There will be many elements of this effort.
We'll report on everything that's been done.
He's done a lot of work on it already.
I also wanted to include the governance because
yes, ma'am.
We're supposed to do, and we're not doing the things that we're not doing that we
correct. All right, Ms. Lawrence, I'm sorry, you yes.
Yes, I just wanted to share that this is a facilitated process to get our ideas on paper. Once it's compiled, then it should be led by a city administrator who will then walk us through it. So what Mr. Crowe is doing is using his skills that he has used repeatedly to get our ideas and to get it on paper. Then absolutely, our city administrator leads it from that
point. I concur. It's about the process. Then we turn it over to the administrator. Ultimately, you're right, and Mr. Lance is right. There will be direct ties to budget, absolutely. So I'm looking for a possible date for this. This would be a single item agenda. We had talked about a Thursday night several times, and we have the 18th. I really do not want to postpone this because this is something that personally I wanted to see happen in January. But Walmart clouded our schedule and then we had attendance issues. So I'm proposing April 18th.
Is that a Monday?
No. Actually, it doesn't have to be the 18th.
Those are a lot of things going on.
Yeah. That's true. How about the 24th, Wednesday the 24th?
That would be, yeah.
April the 24th, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. How about May 8th? That's a Wednesday night.
Sure.
May 8th. Okay. We're going to do a Rule 10, Mr. Frazier.
We don't
know
what you think.
Yeah.
Time to.
You want to start at 6?
Probably should, yeah.
I'm not available.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Wednesday, May 8th is the Socomo dinner that we're hosting as a city. The South Oakland County Mayor's Association in Southfield is actually the host on that.
Can we do May 7th, Tuesday?
I can't.
Tuesdays are bad.
So what about Thursday?
I'm going to be gone week of from the 10th on. I'm going to be. I'll be in China. I'm sorry. I do want to meet.
What was wrong with?
And I've been trying to have this.
What was wrong with the 25th?
There are several things happening that evening.
Well, I know the 18th.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So how about Friday night? Can we do 26? All right.
I'm dead in April.
Don't say that.
May 1st. May 1st is a Wednesday.
Yeah. How about May 1st?
Wednesday?
Wednesday, May 1st. May 2nd.
When are you going to China?
I'm going on a 10th. And I'll be be back on the 22nd.
Try to get a better deal for Walmart.
What about a week from tonight?
Well,
it's ready to go.
Yeah, we could do it on the 15th.
I'm out of town.
Oh, okay. how about, let's do Wednesday Memorial Day.
Let's wait till we'll get back from China.
No, well, we're going to do this tonight.
What about tonight?
Yeah, May
20th.
How about May 20th?
What's wrong with doing on May 6th? Is that another call? What's wrong with that?
What do we have on the calendar?
Yeah, that would be fine.
We have two items on. You've got yours, but you can move. We have a...
Can we move yours to the 29th?
And we have the Section 31, Fred,
right.
Scheduled for that. I don't know if we can move it up.
All right.
That's a workout. It's a big job.
Can you move it forward to the 13th?
Jim, I think we can move that up.
From rather than the 9th?
Yeah.
Okay, what's the next one?
All right, so we're looking at May 6th. It's a regularly scheduled CAL, but we would change the time to 6 p.m. instead of 7.
Okay, now, all right, we'll talk about.
I'll do my items the following month.
Okay, and we'll see if we can move
our. Or if you're ready on the 29th of April. If you can be ready. Okay, then let's do it.
I don't want to interfere with signing. So.
I think we could manage it.
So we're
going to
do
that with
29th.
All right, we're on May 6th.
May 6th.
Starting meeting at 6 o'clock, I'll need a Rule 10 to change the time from 7 to 6. Moved and supported. We're May 6th, Monday. It's a COW meeting anyhow. We'll do it that night. We'll start at 6, and I have a Rule 10 on the floor. All those in favor?
Aye.
I need a motion to move the meeting to 6 p.m. from 7. Been moved and supported. All those in favor?
Aye.
Yay! that was a workout. So, is there any other item to come before this august body this evening? Oh, we do have communications. I'm sorry. Let me do communications. Mr. Jones, I'm going to move you up because let the record show that Ms. Gerald is not here and Mr. Mullen is not in attendance. So the floor is yours.
Speaking to this mic right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Make sure the light's on.
All right, the light is on. I appreciate you guys to let me get this out. This is really interesting stuff.
Your name and address for the
My name is Brian Jones. I'm at 5000 Town Center. There's some cool potential ideas, visionary prospects. First of all, I'd like to applaud the city center effort and the downtown expansion project in parallel with the discussion of the potential for foreign investment into the city by importing culture through language schools, cultural centers, restaurants for Chinese, Japanese, and Russian youths, and business interests seeking expansion or a free platform to compete in the U.S. economy with a visa. These potentials discussed with local and regional restaurants and students and the aversion to settlement in the Detroit area due to the criminal element and political instability opened the market for Southfield's rapid economic expansion, safely moderated by the professional services of Southfield Police Department, ushering in precisely calibrated internationally imported entrepreneurial interests. In the vision of Southfield's tentative projected ongoing strategy to groom itself to be a platform base and trendsetter for statewide business and politics of Michigan in conjunction with the Fortune 500 presence and proximity and cooperation with the city's operational civic center. Also applaud and suggest the expedition of projects to develop and expand activities related to the student, the growth of the student body and its functions for Lawrence Tech and OCC campuses. Also, I'll have a pose a question. Should additional or even vacant real estate be appraised and rezoned and remodeled for restaurant and condominium development in parallel with the housing needs of the induction of additional research and development engineering interests such as Denso from accompanying foreign expansion of technical business prospects. Also, I also had a potential idea for strategies to strengthen security and business productivity at the Northland Shopping Center by getting surrounding youth involved in productive community activities such as security or city streets and lots cleaning projects as employment options and opportunities. J.C. Penney, if no business interest approaches, should be turned into a youth center or Southfield City Service Extension Center in joint cooperation with the adjacent police precinct. There's been similar projects such as this in the San Francisco, California area where they have a lot of the people who are unstable. They put them to work cleaning up the streets. and in addition, there should also potentially be more attractions for the city, such as various different types of cultural centers and museums. I think research should be done of the Tri-City area of Eagle Rock, Pasadena, and Glendale as a model to calibrate the functions of the three cities that were in question from the previous meeting. Also, I think there should be developmental activities to calibrate the integration and introduction of the city center, downtown redevelopment project, foreign cultural centers, and restaurants of academic interest. Should also be a satellite center for surrounding major universities and even the Center for Creative Studies or possibly the introduction of the Art Institute nationwide. There's art institutes all over. I haven't seen any in the Michigan area. Also, I'd like to say that the trip for the courtier international interest is a good move for Cyber to go to China to see what they may have available, because I'm sure they would like to expand it. Maybe Southfield could be the platform for Chinatown in the Metro Detroit area. Also, I'd like to close by saying
15 seconds.
Oh yeah, I'd like to close by saying maybe I could assist with the city planners and commissions and be a greater asset to Southfield, maybe with this, with coming up with ideas and plans, because I can just keep going on and on with this. So,
thank you, Mr. Jones.
Okay.
All right, we're at the council portion of the agenda. Mr. Percassi?
Yes. While I was away, we had an incident in one of our areas, one of our, I call it a bar or a nightclub or whatever. And it's
something that I see happening in Southfield is that we approve a Class C license, and then it's turned around to a management agreement to another individual. And I believe that somehow we have to lobby either the state or see if we can do it ourselves, that any person who has a Class C license, if they go under this management agreement, they have to come before council the same way they do like a brand new Class C. Because what's happening is, and I say this because I had a management agreement when I opened my restaurant, but now that you're being used to promote you can change this management agreement every month if you want. Mm-hmm. And I just think that if we're running into problems at Star Theater, it was a management agreement, And now we have another incident, a management agreement. And I think somehow, when we have a Class C person requesting a license or a change of venue, they have to go through the council and they have to lay out what they're going to do and whatever. And here we have incidents and we don't even know a management agreement even exists.
Great minds think alike, because there's already some action started on this. I'll ask Mr. Moss to respond.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head, Don. We are scheduling a legislative committee meeting on April 18th with the Liquor Control Commission in the Southfield office. Me, Mr. Frazier, Ms. Seymour, Ms. Bain,
residents adjacent to him.
Sure.
You know, we made this guy sign his life away for a Class C license. And I don't want to make it so restrictive that it's going to make people shy away from coming in the city with a Class C. But I really think that, that these management agreements are something that we have to look at very seriously.
Okay. Anything else to come before council this evening? Hearing none, this meeting is adjourned.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, we're going to a close. I need a motion to go in closed session.
So
I'm just thinking about that.
Support.
Yeah, we need a roll call vote. But first, I need a motion. So I have moved by Mr. Farkowski, supported by Mr. Moss. All those in favor going to closed session? We're going to close session, so we'll ask the audience to...